Attention, podcast listener. We've got an exciting new podcast coming just for patrons of patreon.com/talkingsimpsons.
Talking Futurama Season 2 Part 1 has begun exclusively for our $5 and up patrons on the Talking Simpsons Network. That's the first 10 episodes of Futurama coming to you once a week.
So just sign up for $5 a month at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, and you'll get Talking Futurama Season 2 and all of our limited miniseries, including the entirety of Talking Futurama Season 1. That's 13 episodes.
That is patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Now please enjoy the rest of this podcast.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy, hoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, where you strap yourself in and feel the G's. I'm your host, the babe-having millionaire Bob Mackey, and this is our chronological exploration of The Simpsons. Who do we have today?
Hey, it's Henry Gilbert, and I wish I didn't know who Jeremy Piven is.
And who do we have on the line?
You have Nathan Rabin, a.k.a. Hercules Rockefeller.
Excellent, and today's episode is Homer to the Max.
You only wrote my name. I wanted yours.
Take it or leave it.
Today's episode aired on February 7th, 1999, and as always, Henry will tell us what happened on this mythical day in real world history.
Oh boy, Bobby, the AFC wins the Pro Bowl. The first Mario Party game is released on the Nintendo 64, and Payback isn't running away because he's at the top of the box office.
I can only relate to the Mario Party segment of this. I'm sorry.
yes, as listeners learned from our previous episode, the Super Bowl one, we know nothing about sports. I believe the Pro Bowl is just a game everybody takes it easy. It's more of a function. It's like the All-Star game. It doesn't really count or anything.
And everyone takes home a large bowl.
It's the one where everybody tries not to get hurt.
Yeah.
That's the whole point, is if you get hurt in a dumb game that doesn't matter, then your family and everybody knows you will hate you forever.
It's an exercise in good sportsmanship, if anything.
And Mario Party, the Nintendo 64 game, I played the crap out of it with my friends. We broke many a controller because they basically had mini games in it that seemed fine and nice of, like, spin the analog stick as fast as you can to make Mario pedal. It destroys your N64 controller.
They didn't tell you to use your palm, though you should have.
Yeah.
But this game was the subject of a class action lawsuit in which they would later distribute gloves to people.
Oh, it did fuck up my palm, man. It did.
Was it Wario that sued them for this?
We all know Yoshi has tax problems, though.
Yeah.
It's been documented.
It's one of their less successful games. Yoshi has tax problems.
And yes, Payback, the Mel Gibson film, which Homer will reference in about another season.
What even is that?
Oh, you've never seen Payback, Bob?
Yeah. No.
Well, okay. If you can ignore Mel Gibson's involvement.
No.
I think you, especially Bob, would really love it because it is a modern noir. Like, it is, you know, a guy rips off the mob and they're chasing after him kind of movie. And it's like, it's very gray movie. Like, it has like a very blue tinge to everything, but not Lee Marvin. Some other great old guy is in it. It's I remember really enjoying it once upon a time. And now the only scene I remember from it, though, is Mel Gibson being tortured, because there's always that scene in a Gibson movie.
That is what you're thinking about. He's a totally great old dude.
Yes.
Yeah. And that was, I think he played like a classic pulp character. And I believe that was maybe Brian Helgeland's directorial debut. And apparently Mel Gibson kind of came over and finished everything. Ghost directed that. If I remember correctly, it's kind of entertaining and very unsavory, and that inimitable Mel Gibson.
I actually remember one other scene that isn't torture, when the guy we were just talking about, Mel Gibson, shoots his briefcase and fucks up his clothes. He's like, ah, come on, those are all my suits. And then he finds out that Mel Gibson only wants $30,000, and the guy's like, you're doing this for $30,000? My suits are worth more than that.
Kind of like a Dr. Evil ransom is happening there.
It was also kind of a star-making turn for Lucy Liu.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah. Seen that motion picture, you remember her. It's a remake of Point Blank, the great John Glover.
Oh, okay.
That's right.
And that's the other thing, too. It's like, my God, it's got John Glover, William Devane, James Coburn, and Chris Christopherson. That is some serious old white guy energy there. And yeah, it was much, 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 much worse than Point Blank. And also kind of creepy. But yeah, definitely an interesting motion picture.
Adding to Q.
I think it was Chris Christopherson who smashes Mel Gibson's toes when he's tied up.
I'm sure they all wanted to do it. I think Chris Christopherson had the honor.
But they're like, oh, you're enjoying this too much, Mel. We're not doing this anymore.
Kind of creepy. But on the line, we have the great Nathan Rabin, previously of outlets like The Dissolve and The AV Club, now doing his own thing at Nathan Rabin's Happy Place, and the author of the upcoming The Weird Accordion to Al.
Yeah. The very Simpsons-adjacent Weird Al Yankovic. And yeah, there's a lot of Simpsons stuff in the book. Three of my all-time favorite Weird Al Yankovic songs reference The Simpsons.
Well, yeah, Nathan, me and Bob have been reading you for the longest time, probably in both me and Bob's former careers in the games press. We took early inspiration / ripping off of your writing style.
I would say it's an homage.
Yeah.
That is good to know that people who are actually employed in the industry learned from me.
If folks haven't read much of your stuff, like, your reviews of things, especially flops, are some of the best writing about media online, I would say.
Well, thank you.
I mean, and you're also the man who coined the term manic pixie dream girl.
That's right.
I did. That will haunt me for the rest of my life. And it's weird. I think I've kind of gone through a lot of different phases with it, and now I've come to peace with it. I kind of figure you're very, very lucky to make any kind of an imprint in this world of ours, and to come up with a phrase and an idea that's sticky, that has resonance. I feel deeply flattered and deeply honored. At the same time, I've gone through a whole, I was angry, I had weird feelings. It's gone through a lot of weird permutations. I'm a proud, but confused and complicated papa of that idea and that phrase and that term.
Do you think your coining of the phrase helped lessen the appearance of this trope, or?
I think so. I mean, I think I tried to shame people out of having just transparent representations of this. And I think I failed miserably in the movie Aloha. Are any of you guys familiar with the famously failed motion picture Aloha?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Jesus fucking Christ. No, wait, can I swear on this?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Go right.
In fact, swear more.
Well, Aloha was created, written, and directed by Cameron Crowe, who wrote and directed several really, really great movies. But he also wrote and directed Elizabethtown, which I also kind of came around on. And Elizabethtown is the movie that inspired me to coin the phrase manic pixie dream girl. I mean, I'd seen and recognized that archetype before, but this one was just so egregious, so shameless, so utterly, utterly false and fictional, yet self-indulgent. So the fact that Cameron Crowe, the man who created this, or like the purest manifestation of it, later created Emma Stone's character in Aloha, who is the most shameless, ridiculous parody of a manic pixie dream girl. She's also like the most Irish woman in the world, and she was cast as a quarter Hawaiian and a quarter Asian. And I almost just felt like, oh my God, I have failed egregiously because Cameron Crowe wasn't shamed sufficiently to not come back with the biggest / worst / most egregious manic pixie dream girl of all time.
He learned nothing.
So I think I tried to shame people. I don't know that I succeeded.
Well, Emma Stone has apologized for that part, but not for that reason.
Crowe should also apologize for that and the film itself.
Nathan, you know, as a media writer and cataloger, I'm sure The Simpsons were pretty important to you growing up and today.
It was incredibly incredible. I mean, I will go on record as saying that The Simpsons is my favorite television show of all time. I think it's the best television show of all time. I feel like it basically defined the comic sensibility, pop culture frame of reference for my entire generation and generations that followed after me. I actually had a column for Rotten Tomatoes called The Simpsons Generation. No, The Simpsons Decade. You can tell that it really, really caught on and that I, the writer of it, don't remember what it was called. It was going to be a book, and then the publishing industry very wisely said, oh God, nobody wants to read about comedy. They barely want to experience comedy, let alone read about the art of comedy. And so the nice thing is that, like, I failed a lot. When you get to be 43 years old, when you've been in the industry as long as I have, you fail at a lot of things, and it kind of loses some of its sting. that. Mm-hmm. So when I think about The Simpsons now, I think about the enormous pleasure and joy it has given me through the years. I think about the way it has influenced Weird Al Yankovic and in turn, you know, been influenced by him. I have positive, Matt Selman, the Simpsons writer, once bought me the most expensive meal of my life.
Oh, wow.
He was like
nice.
A fan. And being very wealthy, he and another Simpsons writer and Parks and Rec guy, they would just travel around the country going to incredibly fancy restaurants to spend the enormous amount of money that they have. So they came to Chicago, where I lived at the time, and God, I forgot what the place was, but they had like 17 different entrees, 17 different courses. And it was amazing experiencing what it's like to be one of the rich people, you know? And I experienced that for, one magical, magical evening.
Like Homer does in this episode.
Yeah. Then I went back to being, Cinderella.
They have an open invite to come to Berkeley.
I just take the bus back home.
I did want to ask you, Nathan, because you just talked about Matt Selman and meeting him. How often has your career brought you in touch with people who have worked on the show in some capacity?
A fair amount. I think, when I did random roles, such as the feature for the UV Club that I really liked, Will Harris is kind of killing it on there now. Yeah, whenever I talk to somebody, their Simpsons appearance was very, very important. Like when I talked to Mark Hamill, I was as excited to talk to him about doing Luke Skywalker in dinner theater as I was to talk to him about Star Wars. There is a deep, deep, deep connection there. And I actually have a Weird Al Yankovic Simpsons action figure autographed.
Oh, nice.
In my very, very tasteful Weird Al Yankovic shrine. and the funny thing is, part of me is like, oh, Weird Al would like to see my Weird Al shrine. But the same way that somebody who's being stalked would want to see a shrine, for that matter. I think it might impress him, or it might deeply disturb and horrify him.
He's probably seen plenty of shrines in his day, in his 40 years.
And I have thought about getting a tattoo.
a Simpsons tattoo.
Illustrator Philip A. Zaburo is doing amazing, amazing illustrations. To the point where I'm like, if we sell enough books, I would totally get several.
So you must have been watching this episode live when it came out then, the Homer to the Max.
Yeah, oh my God, I was obsessed. I was obsessed with The Simpsons. And one of the unabashed highlights of my career, definitely my time at the AV Club, was this is fairly late in their run, but they had a Portland episode, and it featured Patton Oswalt, and it featured references to The Onion, which was very exciting. But more specifically to the AV Club, which I wrote for. And there was a deal like, oh my God, the show that we all worship, that was like everything to us, just referenced us. Like, that is the coolest thing in the world. Like, it can only go downhill from here. it did go downhill from there. That it was unbelievably exciting. I mean, it was up there, like, I don't know, it was like a background gag in BoJack Horseman. They had something that was written by a character named Nathan Raven, who is a very dynamic Raven who writes, pithy television reviews. I was an answer on Jeopardy. So these are big, 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 big honors when something that you absolutely adore, you get to be a part of, even a little bit, as an adult.
I was a big really AV Club then. I remember that gag on Portlandia. I was like, or the Portland episode of Simpsons. I mean, it was a crossover, basically.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
I did think that was really cool. Like, they're reading what I read. It's just
Matt Selman wrote that episode. And there was like a movie review. So I'm like, oh yeah, that was my shit for a very long time. So they're not just making jokes about the place that I work.
And this week's episode is so insidery. Like, for me, I view this episode a little differently than I did as a teen watching this to an adult now who knows television production a lot better and the behind-the-scenes stories.
Well, I love the idea that the television producers are so accessible that if you have problems with them, you can literally just go to them and they will have a conversation with you about it. Well, I guess kind of the way of doing that now is Twitter. Just yell at people online and tell them how much whatever you saw just displeased them and hope that it somehow gets to them and ruins their day.
They were very diplomatic 20 years ago.
And have any of us been cursed with a famous name or having a famous person? I don't know. Who would that be?
Are you setting me up?
I didn't read. At first I wasn't. Okay. Then I realized I was.
No, my name is Bob Mackey, Macky. There is a fashion designer, Bob Mackey. Mackie, M-A-C-K-I-E. I've known this since I was 3 because people let me know every day of my life. And
he was a superstar.
He is. Like, he is.
One of the giants there. And he's still alive. That's amazing.
Yeah, I believe he's in his 70s. But I mean, what came of it was Milhouse saying, and Bart saying Bob Mackie in season 6. That's the most I got out of it. So there's clips of Simpsons characters saying my name. But after that... No glory. And people still remind me on Twitter every day whenever there's a Bob Mackie article. Look, his name's like your name, like Homer says.
It's funny. If you look him up on Wikipedia, which I totally did not just do, the final sentence of the introductory paragraph is he was a costume designer for Carol Burnett on the Carol Burnett Show during its entire 11-year run. Impressive. He designed costume for its spinoff, Mama's Family.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
I'm sure he'd be very, very proud that, you know, he worked with Ben Midler and Diana Ross and his work on Mama's Family.
Spectacular costumes on that show.
What they have chosen to highlight.
I wonder if that's just counting him designing the costumes for the first sketch of Mama's Family on the Burnett Show.
Well, they had a lot of really nice ball gowns that they all wore. I thought that was a little out of place, but now it makes sense.
I know surprisingly a lot about Mama's Family. I'm sorry. I watched a lot of it as a kid.
Well, for me, the name Henry wasn't one I heard a ton, though I did hate the Looney Tunes Henry. That wherever that came from, I didn't like that as a kid. But also, longtime listeners may know that as a kid, I didn't go by Henry pretty much with anybody. I went by the name Max
Gilbert.
Ooh, and, I like that.
And so this episode came out when I am 16 and Homer changes his name to my name in the show. That's even weirder. It's not just that Homer has a name of a person on a TV show and then Homer changes his name to my name. So I have a name of a person on a TV show.
You know, it's interesting now that I think about it, because Homer Simpson, of course, is the heartbreakingly vulnerable, poignant character played by Donald Sutherland in the motion picture Day of the Locust.
Right.
Have you guys seen Day of the Locust?
No, I'm just aware of that.
Incredibly. It's one of the most depressing, heartbreaking, apocalyptic visions of Hollywood in all of history. Spoiler alert, I believe Homer Simpson, who's just this very gentle, sweet kind of victim of a character, ends the film beating Jackie Earl Haley to death. And in a way, you're like, well, that he kind of had it coming to him. Nobody should beat a child to death. So yeah, I think that's kind of weird that Homer Simpson himself is a legendary pop culture character who also shares the name of a pretty prominent figure in a very important work of American literature.
But he wouldn't even be Homer Simpson if it wasn't for Homer Groening. Like, it was
for sure. That was just a weird coincidence.
I don't know how they do it now, but I heard in the past in interviews and stuff, like, they have to clear names of characters. And if only, like, if a very few amount of matches come up, they have to change the name. But if there's more than a few, they're okay to use the name. And I remember Matt Groening talking in a commentary or something a long time ago saying when the show started, they got a letter from a Homer Simpson who worked at a nuclear power plant and said the show ruined his life.
Yeah, I'm guessing there are probably a number of managers named Michael Scott. Have to be like Mikey or something, or have to figure out a way to get around that.
Well, and the poor people whose last name was Bundy first had a serial killer, and then after that, it's Married with Children.
They were happy with the wrestler, I bet.
Oh, King Kong Bundy, yeah. That's why people's names are Dolph now. They're like, it's just Dolph, like Jimbo Dolph and Kearney. There's no Adolph. That's not a name anymore.
It was like when Michael Jordan had a Hitler mustache. Oh, yeah. Kind of like, you know, if anybody can get away with it, it's me.
That was the weirdest.
And he probably did, you know? It was like, I don't know why anybody in the right mind would have a Hitler mustache.
And I guess before we get into our first clip, this whole mid-season thing, you know, the idea of a mid-season replacement had been around for decades before this. But I do think by 99, it became like a insider term that regular folks were getting to know from like TV Guide or E! News or Entertainment Weekly would be like the mid-season schedule, the mid-season preview. Like they'd start using those terms for shows that used to just be a new show comes out in January.
It used to be considered a dumping ground, but a lot of big shows hit it big in the mid-season. Like the next year would be Malcolm in the Middle for Fox. It was a January show.
Well, and if I remember correctly, Seinfeld was mid-season replacement. And had I continued The Simpsons a decade further, I definitely would have written written about Seinfeld, which was very, very postmodern, very meta, and also spent a lot of time talking about the mechanics of television and the culture of television. I mean, you know, they had an entire season arc to kind of not terribly dissimilar places as this particular episode.
Well, this is an obvious fact, but The Simpsons was a mid-season show. It was not intended to be, but it ended up being one. And right before this episode aired, Futurama was the new mid-season show, along with things like Family Guy.
You know, as we covered in our recent interview with Mike Scully, they knew a slate of three new animated series were coming in the mid-season. So mid-season talk was really getting around in The Simpsons offices, thanks to that.
What were the three animated series?
We got Futurama, Family Guy, and, of course, the PJs.
The PJs, yeah.
That actually kind of lasted. That had a bit of a... It's weird how that kind of disappeared, the PJs, because I felt like it did okay. It had a couple of seasons. It was pretty well received, and then it just kind of disappeared.
Larry Wilmore was like co-creator of the show, and nobody ever remembers that related to him. I was knowing what mid-seasons were just because I was a huge must-see TV watcher, and that's when I knew every show between Friends and Seinfeld would change in January. Be like,
sent to die on Tuesday.
It's not single guy time anymore. It's Boston Common time.
Starring that guy.
I was such a nerd as a kid. I used to read Variety, and I wouldn't just read Variety when I was 11 years old. I paid a lot of attention to the box office grosses and also the television ratings. So there would be a long time when I could probably tell you what was in the top 25. In a related note, I had no friends growing up. I lost my virginity very late.
You're in the right place.
Very much. You're among friends here. You know, friends and sex, you get rid of those things, you got a lot of time to memorize television.
Yeah.
That's my opinion.
It's what matters.
But yes, why don't we get into our first clip of the episode? It's time for the countdown to mid-season.
The start of television's second most exciting season, mid-season, is just 200 exciting seconds away.
Door.
Locked.
Phone.
Unplugged.
Dog, cat.
Taped and corked.
Perfect.
It's America's funniest tornadoes. And at 9:30, All in the Family 1999.
Oh, geez, Daddy got me living with an African-American, a Semite-American, and a woman-American there. And I am glad. I love yous all. I love everybody. I wish I'd saved my money from the first show.
Oh, I can't wait. Look, Marge, I had a scorecard printed up at that all-night scorecard place.
So, Nathan, did you ever cover Archie Bunker's place on your My World of Flops series?
Because that was actually very, very successful. If I remember correctly, it lasted 3 or 4 years.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Danielle Brillebois, whose last name I totally cannot pronounce, but she was the girl, and she went on to become a very successful songwriter.
Wow.
And musician. I guess for some reason that it fucking worked. It was a very cynical idea, but the same thing is like there are a lot of shows that last for a very long time. You don't really think about it. If I remember correctly, the new Monsters had a longer run than the original Monsters.
Really?
You would never imagine that. You would never imagine that. Because you think, oh, the new Monsters is a huge flop. Nobody cares. The original Monsters is like iconic, but you know, a lot of times successful shows aren't as successful as you remember. And the new shit ends up being successful.
Yeah, folks don't know about that. Our All in the Family continued into being Archie Bunker's place as Carol O'Connor kind of became the creative lead over it. For a long time, there were always this... stories of friction between Carol and Norman Lear over the character of Archie, because who made him famous? Who is the true creator of the role? And I think Carol O'Connor had the power as the actor portraying the role. He's like, well, there's no Archie without me, so give me more power over the storytelling. And that ends you up with Archie Bunker's place.
Yeah, well, it's kind of interesting watching this, how much of this feels very, very 1999, very, very dated, and also how much of it feels really, really contemporary.
Yes.
Again, I was kind of watching this. I remember kind of the moments where you most feel John Swartzwelder's libertarian politics.
Oh, yeah.
Are the weakest and most questionable. I'm like, eh.
It feels like kind of a weird shot at Carol O'Connor, though, to say he's like running out of money or something, which I thought he was pretty darn comfortable, I would think, into his...
Well, it's not like these random shots at Lorne Michaels and Jeremy Piven.
Those
really seem to kind of be coming out of nowhere.
They're deserved, though.
They're prescient, and that Jeremy Piven does deserve to be knocked down a peg.
Should be in prison.
Yeah. Also, funnily enough, Woody Harrelson, who will appear later in the episode. Well, not really, but they'll have a Woody Harrelson joke. He did play Archie Bunker in a like live TV revival of Norman Lear stuff. Yeah, they're making fun of Fox's world's blankiest blanks. Also, I got to give it to Harry Shearer. He's doing a good impersonation of Fox video voice guy. Let me play a quick clip here just to remind you guys what that sounds like.
The Simpsons season premiere Sunday on Fox.
Yeah, that guy.
Yeah, but that sounds a lot. I normally think of him talking about a Married with Children. But Harry Shearer's doing a good version of that guy voice, talking about the Fox. And also, I think Homer's mid-season pennant might be his greatest pennant, though his XFL pennant is pretty good, too.
I like his school pennant.
Yeah.
Go school.
Go school. That Homer ranks shows as from very good to excellent.
It's the Jay Sherman scale. Or sorry, the Duke Phillips scale.
Yes.
I apologize.
I was also thinking this is a kind of criticky episode, or at least the third act feels a bit criticky.
Yeah, it does.
But
I had the same response. I was like, yeah, the Schwartzwelder or the Algy and Mercury. I thought, I'm sure they had their fingerprints all over this bad guy.
The Simpsons will be right back.
Hope you're all enjoying this week's dynamic podcast with our special guest, Nathan Rabin. Be sure to check out his Nathan Rabin's Happy Place and also his podcast and his upcoming Weird Al book. All that information is in the description for this week's episode, so be sure to check it out. And if you enjoy this podcast or our sister podcast, What a Cartoon, you should definitely be heading to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. That's where me and Bob release brand new podcasts every week, a week ahead of time, and ad free for both of our weekly podcasts, plus tons of exclusives. It's how me and Bob do this full time, and if you sign up at $5 a month, you'll get to hear next week's Talking Simpsons right now, and the same goes for What a Cartoon, plus our many exclusive Patreon mini-series. We've done The Critic, we've done King of the Hill, and now we're about to do our second season of Talking Futurama. Sign up right now to be able to hear the first 10 episodes releasing weekly of Season 2 of Talking Futurama. All that for just $5 a month, plus our many interviews with luminaries of the Simpsons world, including our most recent one just from last month with Mike Scully, which we talked a bit about on this podcast. You want to hear all the details on there. So please sign up today at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. But if you really want to do things the Max Power way, you got to go up to the $10 premium level at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. You'll get all that $5 stuff I was just talking about, plus access to our monthly What a Cartoon Movie podcast. Me and Bob talk about a different animated feature film once a month, only for our $10 patrons, sometimes over 4 hours long. We go deep into these films. Our most recent one, Cowboy Bebop the Movie, this month in October for Halloween fun. We're doing The Nightmare Before Christmas. And before that, we've done films as varied as Akira, A Goofy Movie, Aladdin, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, and Kiki's Delivery Service. You'll only hear all of that if you sign up at the $10 a month level at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. But yes, as the mid-season ads continue, Homer is a little let down.
Isn't mid-season just a dumping ground for second-rate shows that weren't good enough for the fall schedule?
You're thinking of all the other years. This year's shows are classics. There's The Laughter Family. That's animated. Networks like animation because they don't have to pay the actors squat.
Plus, they can replace them and no one can tell the diddly difference.
And now mid-season kicks off with Admiral Baby.
We're taking the entire 6th Fleet to Candy Island?
Those are the Admiral's orders.
It's hard to believe someone that young could have risen to the rank of Admiral.
Gee, I never thought I'd say this about a TV show, but this is kind of stupid.
Homer finally realizes TV could be bad.
I feel like the parodies in this episode are can be chalked up to the fact that John Swartzwelder stopped paying attention to pop culture in 1986, which is why there are these like very weird high concept sitcom parodies, and also there's a Miami Vice parody in 1999.
Yes.
Like, I feel like that's where the cutoff date is.
I mean, Baby Bob is coming soon after Admiral Baby, so he was a little ahead of the curve on that one. There was the Look Who's Talking TV show in the late 80s, too. So
I guess there was a TV show.
Maybe he's goofing on that. But why don't we talk a little bit about Ned's voice there appearing and what that background is. It's a long story. I'll try to shorten as much as possible. But that there was Mike Scully doing Ned's voice. And he told us all about him doing that voice as kind of a tribute to the voice actor's pay dispute that had been settled just a few months before this episode aired. Short version of it is that when the end of season 9 was coming, all the voice actors, the core casts, deals were up and that they were going to negotiate them together. And around the same time, the Friends actors had just negotiated big pay raises together too to have it all uniform because they knew they could do it better together instead of like, I don't know, they could say, like, well, David Schwimmer isn't worth as much as Jennifer Aniston, which is true.
It's true.
But... quick timeline is that on March 12th, 1999, was the first public news that the Simpsons voice actors were holding out for a raise. At the time, they were currently being paid $30,000 an episode, which is really too cheap for the leads of a show that makes billions for Fox to $19.99. In the news reports on it, Fox was softly floating the idea of like, well, what if we did replace them? They're just voice actors. It's an all too common thing to do in the world of voice acting. And I remember being primitively online in March of 1999 and being very worried of like, oh God, the Simpsons voices, they're going to go away. This will be terrible. But by April 2nd came the news that they had scored a new deal to continue doing the show, which at the time, Variety reported it as they would make $60,000 an episode in the next season, $70,000 in season 12, sources said, and that if the show would make it to the far off year of 2005, they'd all get $1 million bonus.
Going right to Scientology.
I'd love to ask them if they got that $1 million. Like,
yeah. But I think they literally didn't just bring the money truck to their house. I think the money truck was made out of gold and diamonds. And then they got to keep the money truck after it was done backing up all of the money in the world. This might seem excessive, but think about how hard they worked.
I'm sure the executives work even harder, which is why they're worth more.
Harry Shearer in interviews has been very honest about, like, I know this is the easiest job I've ever had, but I am also grossly underpaid for what this thing makes people. And so Harry Shearer, actually, it was funny that 3 weeks after the actors scored more pay was when the 200th episode came out, and that's when they were doing their, you know, big marketing blitz for it and just like tons of interviews in Variety and Entertainment Weekly, all on the history of The Simpsons, talking about making the show. And so, of course, they're interviewing the voice actors and they talk to them about their recent pay dispute. And the least diplomatic in the interviews was Harry Shearer, who said, quote, I find it ironic that a cast deemed instantly replaceable weeks ago is now indispensable. A large number of working voice actors declined Fox's invitation to replace us. They are the ones who acted responsibly. We've been caught in an unpleasant fandango.
Ooh, an unpleasant fandango. I love that term.
That's also the name of his jam band.
Must play it a lot on Le Show. That's I had read somewhere, but now when I tried to find a source on it, I can't find it. But I swear Maurice LaMarche was one of the people who said, like, in 99, they were asked, like, you could just do Mr. Burns and Smithers, right? Couldn't you do that? And he's like, no, I won't do that. I think it is thanks to the fellow actors. And so just to let you know how the timeline on Simpsons pay went after that, in 2004, they negotiated a raise to $250,000 an episode, 2008 up to $400,000 an episode. And then 2011 came a thing that would set the tone for Simpsons productions for the rest of the decade, which is Fox saying they need to cut costs on The Simpsons. Mm. And so the actors went down to $300,000 an episode in 2011. In 2015, they were were asked to continue at that amount. And that is when Harry Shearer briefly quit the show because he didn't
We thought he would leave.
Yeah, that happened in May of 2015. By July, he accepted the terms and just went with it. But I mean, if I am considering myself in the shoes of Harry Shearer and the fucking News Corp executives are coming to me with like, oh, we just got to cut pay somewhere. We just can't afford
this. Whole place is falling apart.
I'm with Shearer of saying like, fuck you. But that's also when, like, you know, Al Jean and other writers on the show were not being particularly nice to Harry Shearer, saying that he was literally phoning in his performance, which he has been for years, like as in calling in. Yes.
A prickly fellow, that Harry Shearer.
He does. I mean, like, it seems like, I think even Michael McKean is like, oh, I've worked with him a million years. He's my friend. Really tough to be friends with. Though apparently it's also Christopher Guest, too. So I think the only friendly member of Spinal Tap is Michael McKean.
He's a saint.
He's a lovely human being. He seems very, very nice.
But yeah, so that's all the background on the Simpsons voice actors. That's when I saw that joke as teen, I did have like a knowing chuckle. And it also felt, you know, kind of edgy for them to joke about such a close to home production issue with the Simpsons.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think the fact that they were willing to do that, indeed do that so often, I think was very, very influential. And I think a lot of other people to do similar sort of things, probably most blatantly a Family Guy, to just continually wink at the audience and let them know that you are forever in on the joke.
But yes, anyway, after Homer reflects on how bad the midseason seems to be, he sees a show he really loves.
Hey, police cops. That sounds like a lethal combination.
Let's get this bank back to a hideout. We'll break into it later.
It's the cops!
Where's the police cops?
This isn't bad.
Isn't bad? Tell me one thing mankind's ever done that's any better.
The Renaissance?
This is better.
Let's book him and roll. And that's the end of that chapter.
You men saved my bank. I'd like to donate $40 to charity in your honor. But I don't know your names.
Lance Kaufman.
Simpson. Detective Homer Simpson.
He's named like my name!
That whole segment is so Swartzwelder-y. The stealing the bank to break into it later, the throwing the goon and having him explode.
The bank manager's like, I'm going to give $40 in your name, and then they high-five each other.
Although we were talking about John Swartzwelder's references all coming from 15 to 20 years earlier. This one seems very, very influenced by Beretta. Catchphrases where I don't do the crime if you don't do the time. You can take dat to the bank, and dat's the name of dat too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's the end of that chapter. Is basically that's the name of that too.
I only know that guy for being a murderer.
Yeah.
he was also one of the little rascals, and he was great in Lost Highway.
He was one of the little rascals.
And I believe did he have like a cockatoo in that Beretta show or something?
He did indeed.
Okay, that's what I thought.
You know him for his bird, his like, positive bird portrayal.
All those cops had their thing, like a sucker or a bird or a lazy eye.
I love that I call Jack. He's the one who has a sucker.
Yeah.
This is such a retro show to be a hit in 1999. That's why I can see why the executives asked for it to be retooled, because they're like, well, this is like a 70s cop show. We need something new to this.
70s cop show meets an 80s cop show in 1999.
They should have made Batch Patrol.
But I gotta say that the police cops is such a simple, such a funny joke. Mm-hmm. It's like a brown paper bag joke, but it's funny because, my God, television cop shows are so unbelievably generic.
You know, I wonder if this mismatchedness is because, you know, maybe Swartzwelder, script-wise, he didn't give directions on design, and he was thinking more 70s style.
Could be.
But then the animators were like, no, this is Crockett and Tubbs. We got to draw them as Miami Vice characters.
With a little bit of Lethal Weapon as well.
Oh, you know, for sure. Well,
John Riggs in that particular peculiar dynamic.
Though also what makes this like not Miami Vice or say A-Team or other action 80s shows is these guys kill a lot of people. Like,
yeah.
Their bullets actually hit people when they shoot them.
And when thrown.
Yeah. I think my line of the episode is Homer's gasp.
It's a very long sustained gasp.
Yeah.
I like it.
Well, because you as the audience, the second the guy says Homer Simpson, you're like, you know he is named after him. But the Homer's gasp lasts so long in his stupid way of saying he's named like my name stretches out the obvious end of this plot point right in front of you. It takes so long. Just like, Homer is very impressed with the show. If he gets to see the guy catch a bullet, throw it back into the man's chest and killing him and then saying, arrest that guy. And Homer sees a lot of new opportunities thanks to this famous name in this next clip.
Wow. They've captured my personality perfectly. Did you see the way Daddy caught that bullet?
That's not really you, Dad. He's just a fictional character who happens to have the same name.
Don't confuse Daddy, Lisa.
Homer, it's just a coincidence. Like that guy named Anthony Michael Hall who stole your car stereo.
Right. Coincidence.
Another person wants to congratulate you for having a famous name.
Hello? Yes, this is the original Homer Simpson. Who's this? The Debbie Pinson, who is the homecoming queen at high school? Yes, I'm still available.
No, he's not.
Marge, that was Debbie Pinson! Debbie Pinson!
No dating!
Tough affair. Apparently, Debbie Pinson appears in another 10 years.
Yes, I actually watched that scene in a season 20 episode. Homer goes to a high school reunion and sees that a guy who beat him for class president ended up being a very successful person. And Homer thinks, you know, if he'd won class president, he'd be the very successful person, not this guy. Homer then gets through a pasta sauce, gets to see an alternate reality where he did get elected class president. And in that reality, he is dating Debbie Pinson. But then when he meets Marge in this reality, he still ends up with her.
Okay.
Then they're just rich and married in that. Yes, that I think that was smart of them of like, well, what high school girlfriend should we have for Homer? And somebody remembered that Debbie Pinson existed.
Because he met Matt Selman.
And it was Tress MacNeille who voiced her there. So no stunt casting there for Debbie. She looks like your typical brunette high school cheerleader. Not much interesting to her design, I'd say.
But I like the running gag. Yeah. He just keeps pushing it. And, you know, this dynamic of Marge being a maternal figure to her husband and her very, you know, naggingly saying, no dating. So many Julie Kavner lines, just her delivery is so wonderfully understated. It's hard to believe someone that young could have risen to the rank of admiral.
That's a great line.
Just the kind of common sense twist that she brings to it just absolutely kills.
I love Homer thinking that he's like, well, I can definitely go on dates even though I'm married. Like,
he's a polyamory pioneer in this episode.
Though, I mean, Facebook is this now. Of just you get to run into your old high school flames and find out how they are doing. Like you don't need to wait for a famous TV character to have the name to find out. Well, and speaking of mocking fame, the Anthony Michael Hall joke, that feels a little mean because look, Anthony Michael Hall was very famous in the 80s and he became less famous in the 90s, but you'd still see him on an odd episode of Touched by an Angel.
He was in
the Dead Zone, you know, everybody thought he was better than Christopher Walken.
Was he in that like Pirates of Silicon Valley thing around this time?
Well, he played Bill Gates. It was wonderful casting, and he did an amazing performance. And there was an LSD scene, very well handled, very artful.
I'm surprised you guys remember this because I didn't remember it. I only knew about it from just checking IMDb of like, what was Anthony Michael Hall doing in 1999? And yes, it's the top billed person in Pirates of Silicon Valley is Noel Wiley as Steve Jobs.
Right.
And he's playing pre-turtleneck Steve Steve Jobs. This is the 1999 idea of Steve Jobs. Yeah, that Bill Gates is played by Anthony Michael Hall in the film, which, you know what? If they do another Steve Jobs biopic, cast him again. He should play him again.
Yeah.
They need to make more Steve Jobs biopics. There just haven't been enough.
Not enough.
And keep getting better and better. I want to see Ashton Kutcher reprise that role.
So this, I'm stealing a thought from a friend of the show, Jack Allison. He notes that Ashton Kutcher is a big investor in WeWork, the, you know, giant failure.
Ooh, yuck.
And he jokes that, like, just because he played Steve Jobs, he thinks he's Steve Jobs. Like, and and he can just throw a couple $1 million at WeWork and be like, yeah, wouldn't you want to work out of an abandoned office? We give you access to that.
It's funny that you're talking about the retooling after the pilot. I recently, for my column, My World of Flops, currently in its 13th year, wrote about Emeril, which is one of my big white whales there. That is a hilarious sitcom. Oh, goodness. Somebody thought that was a wonderful idea, and it got greenlit for like 13 episodes. Robert Urich was his sidekick, which was crazy because I'm like, dude, you've been like 17 successful television shows, including Police Cops. What on earth are you doing on this nightmare? And then, yeah, the pilot episode was half about Lugosi being America's most beloved chef and television performer. And then the second half was about him being a beloved and doting family man. Don't you like the Emeril Lugosi kisses children tenderly to sleep at night and then have sexy banter with his wife? And understandably, the public said, oh God, no, what a nightmare. So yeah, when they retooled it, he never went home because they realized this was a stupid idea to begin with, but we can make it a slightly less stupid idea.
Was he allowed to say bam?
He was allowed to say bam. They worked that into lots and lots of different things. That's the one thing that he said comfortably and naturally on that stupid show.
I thought 9/11 killed that show, didn't it?
Oh, maybe.
Yeah, I was supposed to air on 9/11 and they had to push it back and America wasn't ready to laugh at Emeril Lagasse.
We've had one tragedy today.
Yeah. You have that on your conscience, Osama bin Laden.
You take a different accounting of things after that. You're like, hey, this isn't television anymore. I mean, yeah. I need to see serious things like 24 that capture my anxiety. Homer is really enjoying the fame of having a similar name. I mean, speaking of things that feel different after 9/11, the newspaper saying it's war on the cover.
Yeah.
That's and then nobody caring. That feels like a definitely 9/11 reality.
Oh, yeah. Well, like in the 90s, again, things were good. You know, we had stupid bullshit to worry about. Whereas now we have incredibly important, serious, huge things to worry about.
And yes, Homer is enjoying his fame. He even buys a new scarf that he always wears. And then they tune into a brand new episode of Police Cops at Moe's Bar, but things have changed.
Hey, what's going on? That guy's not Homer Simpson. He's fat and stupid.
Hey, looks like they changed the character into a bumbling sidekick.
No, he can't be. I know. Maybe he's just acting stupid to infiltrate a gang of international idiots. Yeah, that's gotta be it.
You destroyed that drug shipment?
Yes, indeedy.
That was my insulin.
Uh-oh, SpaghettiOs.
Simpson!
Hey, Homer. That character is you all over.
Come on, Homer. Act all stupid. Like you do on TV.
Yeah, come on, dum-dum. Do something unintelligent there.
Shut up! I'm not your clown. Don't diminish me. Gentlemen, I bid you farewell.
Jeez, what an exit.
Oh, man. What's he going to do for an encore?
Ooh, I don't think he'll be doing no encores for a while.
He's just dead at the end of Act 1.
Yeah, it's a very weird place to leave your main character. And then in the next scene, he's fine.
Yeah, it's like, is he going to be in recovery for the rest of the episode?
You know, there could just be a 14-month time skip between these two scenes.
Although, rewatching this, I find it striking how long it takes for them to get to max power. I think when I remember, like, oh, this is the max power episode, the word max power is not uttered until well after 10 minutes into the episode.
Yeah, it's really more about television production than max power or name changing. The new Homer Simpson is like a what the worst Chris Farley scenes would have been, like if you gave bad writers Chris Farley, like, well, what would you write? Like, well, he'd be a big dumb idiot who says ad television catchphrases.
And falls down.
And falls down. The mouth movements are a little off on the Toys for Guns bit. I wonder if they had Toys for Tots before and they're like, that's a copyright name, you got to change it. That's the only explanation I can have for the mouth movements being a bit off there on that. Honestly, I think the executives in the universe made the right move to create a comical buffoon and change up the show. It's I think it probably helped their ratings a lot to have a catchphrase spouting goofy idiot.
They shouldn't have aired the pilot, though.
Yeah,
in most cases, they wouldn't have.
They would have just fully redone. They would have just reshot the whole pilot.
You can poke holes at the plot of a 20-year-old cartoon. But it seems like the pilot was a big sensation to the point where it made Homer famous solely for his name. So it seems like a bit of a plot hole. That's something that seemingly didn't go well, and yet they would then go and change it.
You would occasionally see pilots where things were different and they still aired. Like I remember Roseanne, the DJ, the littlest kid, was different, a different actor. And then in episode two, when they started the series, it was just the kid you know as DJ forever.
You know, my in-universe explanation for that is that the Police Cops was a huge hit in Springfield. They had very high ratings there, but through the rest of the country, very low ratings. And so that's what they must have reworked it within a week. Actually, yes, the behind-the-scenes thing would have to be, they'd have to have recast that before the first episode even aired. So yeah, it seems like just a DJ situation. Or, well, I mean, this whole thing is the official trope name of it is Chuck Cunningham. Syndrome.
Oh, right.
There we go.
Which is named after the Happy Days character who is seen in the first season and a little bit in the second season. The older brother of Richie Cunningham, who disappeared after that, never referred to again. By the end of the series, they were saying things like, I have two children, was what they'd say. Like,
well, for me, the ultimate example of that kind of character is, probably don't realize this, but the first year of Garfield proper, one of the characters in there was like a mustachioed friend of John named Lyman. So if you watch the first year, he's all over the place, and then you never see Lyman ever again.
I love Lyman.
Yeah, you know what happened?
Lyman is Odie's owner, right? In the Garfield lore.
Yeah, I believe so. Yeah, and then he just disappears.
Yeah,
him again.
I believe he did come back for like one panel in a recent anniversary because Jim Davis was told like, oh, Lyman, you guys miss him? Like I just forgot about him. Though, you know, now that Viacom owns Garfield, I think Lyman's going to make a big comeback because they got to exploit every character in the Garfield library.
In the universe.
Also, just a quick thing on Uh-Oh SpaghettiOs that was the catchphrase for decades of the SpaghettiOs brand. In our generation in the 90s, the giant O with legs and stuff, that was the Uh-Oh SpaghettiO guy.
The O's the mouth, but it has a mouth. And then it wants you to remember 9/11 on Twitter.
Oh, it did do that too, yes. Yeah.
They want you to remember 9/11 because it's what killed Emeril Lagasse's job. And he was a big, big fan of that.
And now fake pasta can take over the world.
You know, despite the catchiness of the commercials to me as a kid, and I'd usually buy anything TV would tell me to, I was never a fan of any canned pastas. Like, I didn't like SpaghettiOs or any of the Chef Boyardee raviolis, even if the Simpsons themselves were on a Chef Boyardee can or the Ninja Turtles or Super Mario. I still was just, the idea of pasta pre-made coming out of a tin can, it just seemed disgusting to me.
That's right, because it is disgusting.
It's more like pasta gummies than pasta.
I mean, also, I was heavily in the blue box Kraft mac and cheese / Kraft dinner for our Canadian listeners. I was all in for that. Like, that was like a weekly thing my mom would make me and my brother.
But when the instructions called for one stick of butter.
Oh, God.
Instead of like the fourth of a cup in like skim milk that they have now.
I also think Homer's "don't diminish me" is a little, is overly smart for him, which makes it a good line too, actually.
I love the sort of battered dignity that he brings to lines like that, because he's such a buffoon and he's doomed to always fail, but he tries. And there's just like this glimmer of hope and this glimmer of possibility that, you know, he won't be a buffoon all the time.
It's also a funny meta comment that Homer always is a television idiot, but only when they realize that he's just like a different idiot on TV, then it's funny in a different way that the things that would happen to him normally in any other episode feel different now. Yes, and when we come back, Lisa brings up the very real behind-the-scenes thing of reformatting characters or realizing season one characters that did work don't work anymore. The Chuck Cunningham situation. Like, there's also another great example is Judy Winslow on Family Matters.
Yeah, they erased her from existence.
And also pretty much everyone in the first season is Saved by the Bell.
Yeah, I mean, that was originally a vehicle for Haley Mills, if I remember correctly. And actually, speaking of kind of the, I don't know, maybe one of the most notorious elements of retooling, when Valerie Harper decided to leave her television show, Valerie, that presented certain problems. So they're like, okay, we're going to change it to Valerie's Family. And then they went from Valerie's Family to, I think, just the Hogan. Like when Julia, when she died, I was like, that was the first thing that I thought about. You know, not Mary Tyler Moore, not like all of her incredible successes. That like they're like, oh, you have no choice. My name is in the fucking title. What are you going to do? Like, oh, your name is in the title anymore.
It was not the nicest of. It's not like how they, man, I forget the actress's name, but on the newer Kevin James show, they killed off his season one wife. And they're like, yeah, she got cancer. Anyway, hey, I just met Leah Remini. Though The Simpsons, they make the joke of Mr. Largo and Capital City Goofball, which Mr. Largo is a correct use. I think Capital City Goofball was always a one-off.
Yeah.
He's not a recurring character. Like,
Mr. Largo is technically in every episode.
Yes, yeah, yeah. A better one would have been Dr. J. Lauren Pryor, I think, Or obviously the best one would have been Marvin Monroe, but at least at the time of this episode, within the show's continuity, Marvin Monroe is dead, so he certainly couldn't walk by the window. But yeah, when I think of season one characters that got dumped, too, they seem to have big plans for her. It's J. Lauren Pryor, Marvin Monroe, and also Herman, who would still appear from time to time.
Yeah.
But yes, the show Police Cops gets all of Homer's friends to look down on him. I really love them making a great joke about how poorly you can write a Homer goof up in this sequence here.
Get ready, everybody. He's about to do something stupid.
Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you gentlemen, but you seem to have me confused with a character in a fictional show. Now, if you'll excuse me, my fondue is just about...
There goes Albany.
Uh-oh, spaghetti-o-hose.
Oh, man.
The return of the console from Bart on the Road.
Yeah, it's nice to see the lights again. So Homer killed everyone in Albany, New York, apparently. But yeah, I think that's such a great writing of if they were to write a bad Homer scene of like, if you'll excuse me, my fondue is... Homer is losing it. He's laughed everywhere he goes. And in this scene, the first joke here, I think, has to be one of the darker jokes in the show, too.
Is that Homer Simpson, dude?
People are laughing at me, Marge. Let's get out of here. Forget the baby's medicine.
But our forehead's on fire.
Fine, I'll be in a car, driving home.
Wow, but isn't that stupid cop from TV? Ah, yeah, that got it.
Your catchphrase is hysterical. Please say it clearly from my answering machine tape.
Uh-oh, SpaghettiOs.
Worst reading ever.
How about an autograph?
Picture master? Come on, people. Enough is enough.
Oh, it's never enough. Not for them. Once they get a taste of you, they want more and more and more. That reminds me. Do you mind if my nephew kicks you in the belly?
Okay.
Oh, the flash didn't go off. You got another one in you, Josh?
That was a big laugh for me this morning, especially you think he's going to ask Homer, like, can you do that again? But he's like more concerned about his nephew. Oh, can you so kick him again?
Good. One of my favorite moments in all of cinema, which is the moment in The King of Comedy, where Jerry Langford, who's definitely a bit of a crusty like figure, he's walking down the street and a fan says, oh my God, Jerry Langford, I love you so much. Like, say hi to, you know, my cousin. He loves you too. He's like, sorry, I'm in a rush. He's like, you should get cancer.
I love that.
Yeah, how quickly you turn from adulation to hatred.
I love that scene so much. I just rewatched King of Comedy because my husband hadn't seen it before. So we watched it together before we went to see Joker, as was our responsibility as commentators. We have to have a hot take on Joker. Yeah, it was my duty. But then once we saw it, when I saw Joker and there were scenes that were from King of Comedy, I nudged my husband like, remember that scene from King of Comedy? They just put the Joker in it. Pretty nice.
Batman is always somewhere in the background. You got to find him.
God. I mean, that's, again, why Martin Scorsese's a producer on that. It's just payola to be like, we can just rip off your movie, right, Martin? Like,
well, apparently he was supposed to executive produce it, but like that fell away, which is kind of weird because I always feel like an executive producer credit can be very important. I think Steven Spielberg earned his executive producer credits on 80s masterpieces, but it could also mean, you know, I introduced you to an executive who said hello to this, or I said, hey, this is great, or I gave you early encouragement. It seems like, yeah, it wouldn't mean a whole lot to lose that. So yeah, I wonder, there's got to be an interesting story there.
But yeah, that you should get cancer is such a great line. And I think this too is probably based on the experience of any of the Simpsons voice actors walking around somewhere. Now that everybody has a voice recorder with them everywhere they go, they must be asked all the time of like, could you say, hey, it's Homer Simpson, I'm you're calling me.
That and pictures. I mean, celebrities must be in hell now because everyone has a camera at all times.
I don't want to tell tales out of school, but I remember I had dinner with Weird Al and my wife kind of at the very beginning of us working together. And it was great. I drank a lot of alcohol. He did not. And then I went to the bathroom. And while I was in the bathroom, I did not realize until much later, my wife had him call her dad and say, hey, this is Weird Al Yankovic talking to you on the phone. Like, Jesus Christ. I would not want you to have done that while I was there. Because, yeah, I can imagine how unbelievably annoying it is to be like, say your catchphrase, do your voice, do your thing. It's like, ugh, I appreciate the public adulation, but I'm also
He is very recognizable, even though he's dropped his classic look and he has for like the past 20 years. Like, I can't imagine how gracious he must be to just deal with that all the time.
Yeah, that's a challenge, I would imagine. But he's very, very gracious. And I feel like when you're that level of famous, part of what you do, part of your art is making people comfortable. You know, part of your art is taking photographs. Like, there are a million different things that, you know, go along with writing funny songs and recording them and having that kind of a career.
You know, I'm impressed with Weird Al's ability to reset what people think of when they imagine him, because I know in my head, if somebody said Weird Al, it used to be glasses, mustache, afro, and now it really is. If people say Weird Al, I think of, like, you know, no glasses, no mustache, and flowing locks.
Yeah, for sure. You know, and again, I think just in terms of like the focus of his music and his art, you know, in the 80s, it was all about television and about food. And then, you know, sort of as the aughts have happened, sort of his new muse is technology. And that's great because that's, you know, that has supplanted television as the most important thing in our world, in part because everybody uses, you know, the internet to watch television. It has corrected all the imperfections of the media. There.
But Comic Book Guy is, of course, playing the worst type of fan. That's any anger the Simpsons has towards their fans, they usually put it in the mouth of Comic Book Guy. I will say I was, as a person who is more empathetic than I was as a teen, the joke of Maggie having like a deadly fever, that's less funny to me now. So Homer is starting to go crazy with his unwanted fame. He orders Bart to kill a cat, which seemingly Bart does.
And a flower.
Well, I mean, Bart corked in a cat earlier in the episode, so.
It's a big yellow flower specifically.
Yeah.
Specific murderous rage against one flower in his garden.
It was looking at him.
And I love Marge's line of like, Homer, your growing insanity is starting to worry me. How many wives have said that?
Her delivery there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Julie has some really good flat delivery of crazy things in this. It's funny. Swartzwelder is Mike Reese told us how Swartzwelder would often forget to write lines for Marge and Lisa in his scripts, but Marge is really funny in this one. I wonder if these were additions in the rewrites, mm-hmm. or if Swartzwelder had him the first time.
Yeah, because Lisa just does her Lisa thing in this episode, whereas Marge has a lot of really funny understated lines reacting to Homer and to the ridiculousness.
And then Homer does the very easy thing of flying to Los Angeles and walking onto the set and having a meeting with 13 producers, just like that. This is when it is so insanely inside. Like, this is just all about what famous people talk about with each other, or what television producers, how they even make something. And it's just such a, it's a great gag about how Drek is created. Of just that, I like too that the producers on the show, they blame the executives, but it's like, but you guys had a bad idea too. You're both people with bad ideas bouncing off of one another.
I love Frasier meets Titanic.
I do. It's and again, another way, and this has commonalities with Weird Al's work, where I feel like one of the most resonant themes in his music, especially when I was a kid in the 1980s, was this idea of show business is about money. Mm. And it's all very, very mercenary, and people do whatever they need to do in order to make money. And when I was a kid, I'm like, wow, that seems like revolutionary. You know, it's like somebody was like, you know, pulling the curtain back, like, oh, that's how the world really works. Because, yeah, I feel like, you know, there's this lie that people create television to express themselves and do art. And I think, yeah, this makes merry hash of that fiction.
There has to be at least like five people that do it to tell stories. This guy. Yeah. But yes, Homer gets to meet with the writers.
So I just want to know, how come you made your Homer Simpson character so
stupid? Well, I can assure you it happened organically.
It better have.
The 13 of us began with a singular vision. Titanic meets Frasier.
But then we found out that ABC had a similar project in development with Annie Potts and Jeremy Piven.
Who's Jeremy Piven?
We don't know. But he scared the hell out of us, so we slapped together a cop show instead.
Police cops?
No, actually, it was called Badge Patrol.
But the network idiots didn't want a show about high-tech badges that shoot laser beams.
So we asked ourselves, who's behind the badge?
Police?
Cops?
Police cops.
Yeah, but why does the Homer Simpson character have to be so stupid?
Oh, he's not stupid. He's a street-smart fish out of water in a world he never made.
I'm begging you. I'm a human being. Let me have my dignity back. No!
Walks to a cactus.
Let's talk about Jeremy Piven.
Yeah, this is pre-Entourage. He was still on Ellen, starring the famously very nice person, Ellen DeGeneres.
Yeah, what a great lady. No.
He was also on Larry Sanders' show.
Oh, yeah.
In the 90s, they were really trying to make Jeremy Piven a thing, especially in the late 90s. Actually, this joke, I think, is especially about how in 1998... Jeremy Piven slowly exited from Ellen. Like, he's, after she comes out, he's in way fewer episodes. And I think his, I read it as his management was like, get him off of this controversial lesbian show.
He's got to grow his hair back.
That did let him buy a nice new set of hair. But so when this episode aired, it was actually right after the premiere of the first Jeremy Piven fronted sitcom called Cupid, where he...
Oh, I remember Cupid. He played the role of Cupid.
Yes, yeah. He's, I believe he was a guy who's really good at dating, but he thinks he is the literal god Cupid in flesh form, right?
You'll have to listen to my Cupid podcast in order to find out.
But I think they're making fun directly of Cupid. Like how... Well, also, Annie Potts was getting put in the lead in a lot of, like, failed sitcoms at this time, too. It's just so weird, like, the 8 million chances Piven has. I feel like he's just so inside the industry. Like, they just kept going, like, well, Piven didn't work out in this thing, and PCU, what if we transition him to TV? Well, maybe he can lead his own sitcom. Huh, that didn't work. Well, I mean, let's just put him in Entourage. And that's when it finally stuck, and the Piv got to get famous.
And we were stuck with him, actually. So Cupid... In the series, I'm looking this up now, he believes he's Cupid, sent down to connect 100 couples using his powers, but he only connected 15 because that's how many episodes they made.
And this is interesting. It was created by Rob Thomas, Not the hack-song writer behind Matchbox 20 and the song Smooth, but the writer and creator of Veronica Mars.
Yeah.
Party Down and iZombie. Well, co-creator, because I know Paul Rudd is co-creator of Party Down. Those are some very, very impressive credits. And Cupid had a bit of a cult. People enjoyed that television program. Wow.
I also was unaware that Jeremy Piven is the brother-in-law of Adam McKay, which explains why he's in all that Adam McKay stuff. And of course, you haven't heard much of Jeremy Piven in the last 2 years because a lot of allegations came out about him, and he denied the first couple, and then after about, I think, the eighth woman...
Just stop responding?
Yes, he kind of disappeared, and good riddance, I say.
Not to tip anything, but part of me is like, is Bill Clinton canceled?
I think he is. We'll get to that in a minute, but yeah. I do think so. Scott Aukerman had the joke of just saying, like, Jeremy Piven was one of the first people who got Me Too'd that everybody's like, oh yeah, no, I believe that, yeah. Like, no
well,
one
was shocked. The same thing. Where it's like, that moment could have existed solely to expose people like James Toback, whose whole mythology was, I get laid constantly. It's because I'm so smart and talk so good. It's like, no, it's because you're a rapist.
Yes. Yeah, it's hard to think of most stars of the 70s not being all Me Too'd today. Like, though also, like, can you believe the set of Entourage was filled with sexual harassment? I can't. No way.
I thought it'd be very progressive and open.
you know that the Jeremy Piven's character is based on Rahm Emanuel's brother. Like, that. So, I mean, this episode, because Swartzwelder hates Hollywood liberals, this is the anti-Hollywood liberal episode.
Chicago politics.
Though I am more into anti-Hollywood liberal every day these days, but from a left-wing standpoint, I should say.
Yeah, definitely. My problem is not that they're too environmentally conscious or that they care about the world too much. It's closer to the opposite of that.
But yes, Homer, I think, actually does have a lawsuit on them that they just recreate a thing he did and put it on the show. I always wonder, like, how many TV shows some line given to a character is to make fun of a person they met in real life. Like, how many are just the settling of scores. But the Homer Simpson on the TV show, it shows that they thought of a funnier way IRL to do a joke of Homer walking to a cactus instead of the very ridiculous dropping off a flagpole to land crotch first onto a cactus. And yes, Bart identifies him as stupid and whiny now. I think this is the last time we see police cops within the show. I have to think it lasted one season.
Yeah,
and got canceled after.
The retooling didn't take.
It's not like Beretta or Mama's Family or Dead Zone, the TV show, which was on for 6 seasons.
Wow.
But yes, Homer takes it to court.
Let me down, Chief. I'm begging you. I'm a human being. Let me have my dignity back.
Nice, stupid, and whiny.
That does it. There's only one thing I can do. Your Honor, I'd like to sue the producers of Police Cops for $20 million for improper use of my name.
Court finds in favor of Police Cops. Next case.
Okay. Then I'd like to legally change my name.
What name would you prefer?
Any of these will be fine.
Hercules Rockefeller. Rembrandt Q. Einstein. Handsome B. Wonderful. I'm going to give you the only name you spelled correctly. From this day forward, your name shall be...
Max Power?
Dynamic, isn't it?
I love it, Max. You changed your name without consulting me?
That's the way Max Power is, Marge. Decisive, uncompromising, and rude.
This whole Max Power philosophy thing I really like.
This is dynamism. This is being a go-getter. Homer has transformed himself. There was one thing that struck me in this, a sad thought that came to me in this courtroom scene. Lionel Hutz would have been here, and the lines Homer said would have been his.
It would have been a longer scene, too.
Yeah, yeah. I think, Homer representing himself makes it funny in its own way, but, like, this is one of our, if not the first courtroom scene in the show since Phil Hartman's passing. I do like the gag of Homer seeming to introduce the next plot point, which is a lawsuit against a TV company, but then he's like, no, actually, it's not that. He's like, oh, let me shuffle my papers. Okay, here's the other idea for an episode. And the changing of one's name, you know, I've never considered it, even though I am the third of my namesake, and it's I am not a big fan fan of the lineage of my name. So I've still, even though I went by Max when I got a job in the professional field, I was like, Max felt like a child's name. So to me it did. So I wanted to just feel like a grown up, and I've gone by Henry ever since.
Well, I feel like there's kind of this cult of self-improvement that we have in the United States. And I feel like this is kind of a delightful burlesque of that idea, kind of taken to the irrational extreme, that simply having a silly new name could cause people to think that you're amazing. It also reminds me a little bit of the episode with where he has hair.
Yeah.
Similarly, like, oh my god, this one change transformed, and I'm bald, so I have thought about, like, what would my life be like if I had, like, a rich, thick head of hair, and I do think that, you know, people probably would maybe look at me differently. Maybe they would respect me more, maybe they'd respect me less, but yeah, I think it is an interesting idea that these very kind of superficial changes can completely transform your life.
I mean, both this and that episode are about just how skin deep everything is in especially in the world of business and success. Like Homer's ideas are no more less good or bad when he, depending on what his name is. And I mean, it does also make me think to the modern billionaires of today, who are just like rich guys who people treat like they're smart, like say Elon Musk, who are just like, yeah, what a genius. It's like, it could be he just bought PayPal first. Like,
yeah.
The Max Power name is so funny. Handsome Be Wonderful would have been a good name too. I do think he probably would have opened the most doors with the name Rockefeller. That would people would just assume like you've got to be related to that family.
There's actually a famous story about a con artist. My wife read a book and I watched a movie about it as well. But a con artist who passed himself off as a Rockefeller. And was able to do a whole lot of things with that, including, if I'm not mistaken, murder some people. But yeah, if you look up Clark Rockefeller, it's a fascinating story about how a name, even a fake, wrong, stolen one, can legitimately change your life and cause people to see you much differently.
And then Abe says a bunch of nonsense about where the name came from, which is so superfluous that the no character comments on it and then just turns away.
It just moves on. He still has traded it for a mule that saves spring break.
Yes. This feels like a very Gene and Reese era kind of use of grandpa, which is just like, I think they need to identify like 20 seconds that could be cut out if they need to. So they just have Abe say some old bullshit and they're like, well, we could cut that if we need to. Then we learn of a secret tattoo of Marge's in this next clip.
Oh boy.
But this will be so confusing. The mailman won't know what to do. Did you think of the mailman at all before you did this?
Yes, briefly.
And what about the tattoo on my you-know-what?
Oh, honey, they have acids that can burn that off.
But I fell in love with Homer Simpson. I don't want to snuggle with Max Power.
Nobody snuggles with Max Power. You strap yourself in and feel the G's.
Oh, Lord.
And it doesn't stop in the bedroom. Oh, no. I'm taking charge. Kids, there's three ways to do things. The right way, the wrong way, and the Max Power way.
Isn't that the wrong way?
Yeah, but faster.
We should really put that in the corner.
All the cruelty towards Marge. Not even getting laser treatment. Yeah. No acids.
It has to be acids that burn it off. Which would especially be painful in whatever secret area she doesn't want to say in front of the children. But damn, man. Homer. Also, Homer, I think, is really overestimating and overpromising on feeling the G's and strapping in.
Though I recently watched the movie The Human Tornado. I did a big rewatch of all the Rudy Ray Moore's movies in anticipation of My Name is Dolomite. And I was delighted to find out or re-remember that the nickname of The Human Tornado is about how good he is at fucking. A sexual nickname. It's not about how, like, ooh, he's like, you know, fists of fury and kicks. It's kind of a similar thing. And the Max Power is all about Homer in the bedroom.
That's what tornadoes are known for, right?
Yeah, exactly. For being good at making love.
This is maybe one of the shortest act twos as well. Like, I think it's like 4 minutes, but that's because it also has a really long act three. But Homer, I think Homer walking into the cactus is the right blow off for act two. You need to come back to the new reality of Max Power. I think they picked the right place for a cut. But yes, we come back. Homer is singing the Max Power theme song.
Max Power, he's the man whose name you'd love to touch, but you mustn't touch. His name sounds good in your ear, but when you say it, you mustn't fear, 'cause his name can be said by anyone.
Ah, Max Power, how's every little thing?
You remembered my name.
Well, who could forget the name of a magnetic individual like you? Keep up the good work, Max.
Mr. Power?
Yes, of course, Mr. Power.
It's weird to see Burns appear in these seasons. He's just so not on the show anymore. So I was happy and surprised to see him.
Yeah, you know, I think they've fallen out of love with Burns right now. They've done so many Burnsy episodes. I think now they're sowing their oats somewhere else. But yeah, this feels like a real like early years callback of Burns now remembering Homer's name, and the Goldfinger theme song coming in there. That's pretty great, especially the line like, because his name can be said by anyone. That's a good reason not to fear.
But don't touch his name.
Homer is finding tons of new opportunities. He also, I agree with him, monograms are out. You should just have your full name on your shirts.
With exclamation points and a pirate flag.
Because each letter is as important as the one that came before it, if not more important. No, as important. So, yes, Homer then meets a similarly powerful named individual.
The man knows what he likes.
Just taking care of business.
If you don't, who will, huh? Trent Steele.
Homer Max Power.
Oh, hey, great name.
Yeah, isn't it? I got it off a hairdryer.
I like a man who can poke fun at himself. Ooh, hey, my 1 o'clock canceled. Have you had any lunch?
Yeah, but I usually have 3 or 4.
So where to eat? You like Thai?
Thai good. You like shirt? Art, this is Thai food. From now on, I want it morning, noon, and night.
When did you start liking Thai food?
When Trent Steele bought me some.
Who's Trent Steele?
He's Max Power's oldest and dearest friend.
What's this wrapped in a banana leaf? Smells like mint.
Oh, I spit my gum in there.
Ew. Where'd you meet this Trent Steele? Moe's?
No way. This guy's a winner. He has a company that makes computers, or a computer that makes company. Anyway, you wouldn't understand.
Homer getting invited into the cool guys club just based on his name. I really do love the gag. And like, Homer is clearly an idiot, but this guy is so impressed with his name. He's like, you're so pithy and funny. Oh, man. Which is how it works in executive boardrooms.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just about how well you can promote yourself. And also the line about computers that makes companies, it does feel like it's about what rich people were in 1999 and pretty much all forward of just like, they're not robber barons. They're of things that you can identify of like, oh, he's a plastic magnate or whatever. And says like, well, he's rich for a reason I can't quite figure out.
We're inflating the tech bubble.
I just go to venture capitalists and say, I'm going to do something involving computers. And they'd be like, here's $1 billion. Knock yourself out. No oversight whatsoever.
Yep. Yeah. As all three of us working in the online corporate media field, we've enjoyed so much of this kind of reality that we get to see a stinging example of every day, that to say, like, when Splinter News gets shut down or one of a dozen other places.
And the world gets worse and worse every day.
Yeah. When you make a Patreon, it's kind of like making a company, right? With your computer.
It's true. I love the reveal that Homer came up with it from a hairdryer. Like that, the pacing on that reveal is so great, because they could have put that joke there the first time you hear Max Power, but by delaying it by like 2 minutes to finally find out that it's just him reading a hairdryer makes it even more funny, the reveal.
Yeah, it could be read as Homer being dumb, but also it could be read as a self-aware joke that Trent Steele is seeing it as.
And Thai food seemed very outside to me in 1999, living in the suburbs of Florida. But man, now I have like, there's I'm like spoiled seven, for Thai choices around here.
There are seven Thai food places here.
Well, it's also like in the 1980s, you would see sushi referenced as something very exotic that only like the cool, hip, you know, dynamic people are into. Now it seems a little bit more mainstream.
I'd say a bit more mainstream, though. Me and Bob maybe don't have the best measure of it because we are in the Bay Area bubble. We don't understand how normal.
Food bubble.
Yes, food bubbles. Not monetary bubble. No way.
It's more of a dome.
And so Homer is now being invited into the Great People's Club. He seems to have also invited Debbie Pinson there, though I think Marge must have uninvited her. And they arrive at a fancy house and they say, everything, we're going to be spelling out everything with letters from now on. This is a weird bit here because they say it's in Springfield. Homer says this is Springfield's elite are gathering, but this is such a Hollywood party.
Brian Glazer is there.
Lorne Michaels, Woody Harrelson.
Is there as well, who I don't think spends a lot of time in Springfield as established.
Yeah, actually, Alec and Baldwin already established that nobody knows where Springfield is. Like, I guess maybe they've been told now by Alec and Ron Howard that they should go there.
It's a new hotspot.
Well, I like how they're so inside that they don't even specify that, oh, that's Brian Grazer and Jerry Bruckheimer. You're just supposed to know what they look like.
Well, they just pulled out the Brian Grazer character model they used in the Alec Baldwin episode. I'm also surprised they couldn't just get Woody Harrelson. That's why I feel if you can't get Woody Harrelson, don't do that joke. That's what I think. It's though I guess this was before pot was legal. This joke feels kind of like hokey now. Like, yeah, pot. We all can smoke it.
This man enjoys pot.
Yeah. I believe this hemp gag here. I mean, he talked about like he was on some Tonight Show type thing and said like, I'm wearing pants that are pot or made out of hemp, and you can make hemp out of all these things. And in 96, he got arrested for growing hemp in Kentucky.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
If you your stoner friends knew all about this guy,
there are monthly updates in High Times.
But also, like, when he was one of the most at his highest in fame as Woody on Cheers, like, he was one of few celebrities taking the unpopular stance of Desert Storm is a bad thing to do and we shouldn't do it. Like, it, which, you know, that seems extra gutsy these days.
Oh, it's he has to atone for his father killing JFK. which is totally a conspiracy theory that exists.
That's amazing. Yeah, that's we all know it was Ted Cruz's dad.
It's true. Yeah, and Woody Harrelson, the character Woody on Cheers is stupid.
Yes,
and he's the same as him visually, so he's probably living that same hell, or was like 20 years ago.
Yeah,
that is true. I like the guys on It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
Oh yeah.
They're going to play horrible, horrible people with their names for a period of decades.
Charlie Day, do something stupid. Come on.
Break the law.
You can't read. But yes, Homer is mingling with elites.
And there's Ed Begley Jr.
And this one solar collector can gather enough energy to run this colorful pinwheel. Wait, I got it.
Very nice, Ed. Your inventions continue to impress me and the entire nation.
March, President Clinton.
Oh, my Lord. I feel like Cinderella.
Me too. Let's sing the Cinderella song.
Maybe later.
Uh-oh. Here comes Lorne Michaels. Pretend you don't see him.
Ah, Max Power. Trent said I absolutely must meet you. This is fabulous.
Anyway, Marge, how do you feel about the economy? So I said, if this is the house of pancakes, how come I can't eat the walls?
Oh, you are too much, Max.
I thought I knew all the players in Springfield. Or have you been hiding yourself?
Well, I spend a lot of time on the couch.
Tell me about it.
Haven't we all?
Here.
I like all the characters misreading Homer's stupidity and sloth and bad characteristics as him being witty.
I love that. Yeah, it's such an emperor has no clothes kind of thing. I like it. It leads you to think like, well, if they accept Homer for this, how are all of them frauds? Are none of them actually witty?
The answer is yes. All celebrities are frauds and phonies, except for Stacey Dash. watching that gag, I remember thinking, I think everybody in comedy has a reason to hate Lorne Michaels, or at least to resent him. But this particularly, he fired John Swartzwelder.
Yep.
After one season as a writer on Saturday Night Live, 1985, which I actually covered for My World of Flops. Interesting, interesting season. And then Harry Shearer quit in disgust twice. Actually, times when like Michaels wasn't there. You know, I think like towards the very end of the 70s and then in the 80s. But I'm sure he has all sorts of reasons to hate Lorne Michaels, even if they did not collaborate directly together.
I feel like everyone who worked with him does an impression of him.
Yes, yeah. Well, it seems like even the guys who like him or still produce shows with him, they still make fun of him. Like, they all are just like, well, I'm Seth Meyers, and yes, he produces my show, but also, isn't Warren a weirdo? Like, always with his white wine and his many blonde assistant women? Like...
Well, there are the characters that are clearly based on him, you know, like Dr. Evil, probably the most famous, and then I know in Brain Candy.
Oh, yeah.
Mark McKinney played a character who was obviously based on Lorne Michaels.
I got to tell you, that I felt like the stupidest dum-dum in the world that I didn't realize that was Lorne Michaels until me and Bob were blessed to get to attend that Brain Candy 20th anniversary thing at Sketchfest a couple years ago. And McKinney played the character live on stage, and the second he said a word, I was like, oh, that's Lorne Michaels. They're making fun of him being a completely useless control freak who ruins everything. I mean, yes, especially Harry. It's funny that Harry is doing Lorne, because on that same WTF I referenced earlier about how Harry talking about his pay grade on the show, he also talked about working with Lorne on SNL and how Lorne is this kind of Svengali figure who made people think this is the only way to make sketch comedy. And Harry Shearer in the late 70s, he's like, I had already come from successful sketch comedy. I knew this is not how you run a show, and this is stupid. And me being there to say this dogmatic approach to comedy is a bad way to make sketches, Lorne hated him for that, which I believe is true, because they're still doing that to this day. It's like, well, no, the only way to write this show is to rewrite everything at 4 a.m. on Friday night. Like, that's a great writing. And the success of the incredible comedy of SNL, I think, bears that out. It definitely works.
Nothing's funnier.
Yeah, a friend who interviewed to be a writer on Saturday Night Live, and then he made it all the way to, you know, being interviewed by Tim Herlihy, who I believe was the head writer at that point. And he said that would probably cost him the job was that he wasn't appropriately deferential about Saturday Night Live. He wasn't like, oh my God, this is what I've been, you know, living for all my life. You know, this is the epitome. This is, you know, he was like, eh, it's a job. It's a pretty good job, but it's just a job. So yeah, I think there is this idea that if you really want to do well at Saturday Night Live, you need to kiss the ring of power. And you need to make Lorne happy, and he makes everyone on edge by withholding validation and approval and making, you know, all of his children compete for his favor.
Yeah, I remember Jenny Slate talking about her experience on SNL, and that for the dinners they would have after the show, people had assigned seats, and their proximity to Lorne was based on how much he liked them.
Yeah, it's,
and she couldn't change her seat. She wanted to sit next to somebody else, and she couldn't change her seat. It was like a really creepy story.
It's a cult. You hear, and we know these things because we were Saturday Night Live fans, so we read all the books. We all read Live from New York and have seen all the specials, so we know this. But like, yeah, I think as I get older, the less I like Saturday Night Live, and this kind of cult-like atmosphere you read about these days feels even less useful, because it's like, you do all this to do like 3 good sketches a year, maybe, and one of those is just John Mulaney showing up and writing one, like, not the regular writers. Like, but I feel bad for the writing staff anyway, because it sounds like, post Seth Meyers, it sounds like there's not really been a true head writer of the show since then, and certainly not a fucking loser like Colin Jost. I hate that piece of shit. But but because there's no clear head writer, it's just a messier show that also has a lot of sponsored content in it now.
Really?
Oh yeah, they just had a
ideology. It's so anti-establishment. It's the spirit of Lenny Bruce coursing through every second of this transgressive, subversive comedy. I'm shocked to hear that.
I know.
I mean, previously they were a campaign ad for somebody, but now they're...
There's so many reasons to hate Lorne Michaels. Though at the time in 99, as a... big SNL fan, especially as like we were entering the Will Ferrell years, I was like, why are you mean to Lorne Michaels? He makes a good comedy show. I like the idea that they all try to ignore Lorne Michaels at parties and no one wants to talk to him. And it's also, I do think in the current atmosphere with Lorne Michaels, I do think it's crazy that even dudes who got fired, like David Spade and Norm MacDonald, they're not blaming him, Lorne Michaels, right now in the current firing of people gate of SNL. They're blaming the culture or all this stuff. It's just, and like, that's really sad to me because I think Norm MacDonald is one of the funniest dudes who ever was on SNL, but he's also like 65. So, it happens.
He has the political opinions and the sensibility and the, I think, default hostility towards young people and aggression, the idea that like people are being challenged, people of his age and his generation. And I think if you're a comedian, you're kind of arrogant by definition. You know, you make your living going to places where people pay money to see you. And then your voice is amplified above those of everybody else around you. So I think, again, kind of people, especially people in power, you know, they have a sense of their own importance that can play havoc because, you know, society changes and a lot of times people do not change with it.
It's hard to change. Mm-hmm. I agree. Hey, look, in 20 years, I am going to be struggling with changing society, too.
Trying to avoid having grandpa brain.
Well, actually, in 20 years, there's just no potable water, and so no. I won't have Twitter to complain on anyway.
On the plus side, we'll all be dead by
then. Yeah, I mean, we can all look forward to that. Let's talk about Bill Clinton as well here. I mean, this is Mike Scully.
A class act all the way.
So Mike Scully, we asked him about what it was like writing during this impeachment since, you know, impeachment talk is all the rage right now. And so what was it like then? And he did mention that Swartzwelder was really sowing his oats on how much he hated Bill Clinton, and that he would say, guys, I bet you $5 Bill Clinton is going to hang himself in the Oval Office by the end of this year. Like, that's how extreme the Swartzwelder was getting. And now, yes, you had hinted at earlier, Nathan, I think we're all kind of realizing, like, oh, Bill Clinton's fucking gross. Like, no, he's bad. This is a bad guy. I'm shocked at so many liberal folks just kind of had this blind spot on him. And the more you hear stories about him, like, oh, that is gross. Oh, that's pretty bad too.
Yeah,
I guess he was. I think it hurt it that like Rush Limbaugh in the 90s also was saying these things. So I didn't want to agree that Bill Clinton was a sex monster. So you just wanted to be like, well, yeah, Rush Limbaugh is lying about this. But
that's that whole idea of the enemy of my enemy is my friend, you know. But again, I think at the time I wasn't crazy about Bill Clinton. I voted for Ralph Nader in 1996, the first opportunity that I had. Because again, I think even then it kind of sounds like there's just something really gross and wrong and compromised and creepy about him. And part of my frustration and disappointment with this is there's so many good things to make fun of Bill Clinton about. He's such a flawed figure. He's such a problematic figure. He's so lacking in self-awareness for such a master politician that to be like, I like to do it and we're going to do it in the outhouse. I'm like, oh God, please, you can do better than this Simpsons in near the end of your prime.
For these shows, he was mostly a vehicle for hillbilly jokes. Mm-hmm. And the critic joke, a fat, lecherous hillbilly elected president.
That pretty much sums up their stance on
it. Somebody like eat junk food, you know?
Yeah.
These are very stupid things to make fun of somebody about. And then he was overweight.
I mean, that was the small hands orange man of its time.
Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of comedy, they don't want to engage. If you engage deeper than that, then I think it's seen as taking more of a political stance. So instead it's like,
we can all agree Bill Clinton has sex with animals, right?
Yes. Yeah.
No matter what side of the aisle you're on.
And I think that's the idea of kind of doing it in a political kind of way where we're not criticizing policies. We're not satirizing, you know, his political beliefs. We're just saying this dude's a redneck and he likes to fuck. And those are very, very limited, you know, tools for a satire or amusement. And yeah, I felt like that's the part where this episode just hits a bunch of really wrong notes.
And the both sides angle on it too feels like these were Hollywood liberals showing off of like, see, we maybe all voted for Clinton, but we can make fun of him. We can call him a bestiality committing hillbilly. But... but then when it turns around to the other side, like they post 9/11, they didn't make fun of George Bush, nope. W. Bush once. Mm-mm. Like, though then again, now they're making very bad jokes about Donald Trump. So I kind of prefer if they didn't do that.
Don't mention any presidents outside of the mediocre presidents.
I haven't watched The Simpsons in a long time, except that I saw the the clip that went viral for all of the wrong reasons about the squad and Donald Trump and, you know, their parody of Rodgers and Hammerstein.
Yes.
And yeah, I have. Like, you gotta, you know, you need to tackle, you know, the biggest issue and problem in society, but you need to not do it in such a horribly hack way that, like, you end up making people feel sorry for him and look down on you. Because,
well,
again, I feel like if, you know, you talk to Hollywood liberals, you know, I'm guessing, people in The Simpsons have a fuck ton of money.
Oh, yeah.
And it probably influences the way they live their lives and as the way it tends to.
Are you saying Harvard graduate millionaires are out of touch, Nathan?
Yes, yes, yeah. That's exactly what I'm saying. And they've also been super fucking rich and super successful for 20, 30 years. So you're going back a very, very long time to when you were doing the same shit that everybody else does.
Well, I mean, that clip with the squad, one of the things that bothered me most of all, other than being not funny, which was certainly not that, and feeling like a sub-SNL kind of Trump jokes, which I didn't think that was very funny either, but it was that they took these, you know... very left-wing members of the Democratic Party like Ilhan Omar and Rashid Tlaib and all these people and we're giving them like the fucking Nancy Pelosi centrist bullshit. I'm like, no, they say different things and I don't think they understand that they are not normal Democrats and that's also why they're getting targeted beyond just being women of color who are easy to attack if you're a white supremacist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there are specific lines. I mean, the line that you were alluding to about Bill Clinton engaging in bestiality is, hell, I've done it with pigs. Really, no fooling pigs. That's a line I would have cut out a censor. You know, and it's just like, yeah, it's not funny.
You're saying and the president fucks pigs. Like, that's a weird line to go with.
It wasn't a Monica Lewinsky joke, right?
Too. It's such a, you're from Arkansas, so y'all must be, you know, illiterate, subhuman, pig fucker. It's
definitely like, yeah,
things to make fun of him about that to just go in this direction is sad and also not funny.
On the commentary, they say they're not making a fat joke about Monica Lewinsky, but I absolutely think that you're supposed to be thinking, I've had sex with pigs, is him saying Monica Lewinsky is a pig, which like is... she got to face a whole lot of cruelty. It was pretty awesome back in the 90s.
Yeah, I hadn't even thought about that. Wow. That takes something ugly and makes it even uglier.
Yeah. What's also fun, if you wanted to get really dark in this sequence.
Oh, no.
Just imagine that at this party, just off camera, is Jeffrey Epstein. He's hanging out with Homer at this too.
Or Harvey Weinstein.
Oh, he's totally there.
Yeah.
He's right up there with Jerry Bruckheimer and Brian Grazer. You know, those are the big titans of Hollywood.
Yeah. Don Simpson would have been there if he hadn't died. Thankfully, a couple years before this. And I mean, also, Bill is being such a creep on Marge. Like, it's a disconcerting scene that he forced, like, literally forced himself on her. So, like, well, it is a law. You have to dance with me. Like,
yeah.
Like yuck. Just
and
yuck.
He later invites her to fuck him in the tool shed.
Yes. That he's.
The White House where he spends most of his time.
I mean, we just. Let's hear the clip.
I know you don't think you're good enough for me, but believe me, you are. Hell, I've done it with pigs. Real no fooling pigs.
Are you sure it's a federal law that I have to dance with you?
You know, I'd change that law if I could, Marge, but I can't.
I wish I could have seen
this. Oh, shoot. Quebec's got the bomb. Well, I gotta go, but look, if you're ever near the White House, there's a tool shed out back. I'm in there most of the day.
Attention, please. Attention, I just want to say how thrilled I am with this turnout. I'm proud to share my home with Springfield's best and brightest.
Hey, no problem.
We've all been blessed with privilege and success.
Woo! Privilege!
But with privilege comes grave responsibility.
What?
We all have to give something back to the world that's been so good to us.
Give something back? Boo! Get a haircut!
I'm talking, of course, about our endangered forests.
This is where it gets kind of South Park-y, too.
Very much.
Yeah.
Well, I think Swartzwelder and South Park come from this same kind of, you know, late 90s nihilistic belief of, like, it's gay to care, like, which South Park, like, straight up says.
Yeah, like it, or you have another self-serving agenda for caring about something.
No one would care about the rainforest if they didn't, if they weren't doing it for likes or for attention, and it's like...
virtue signaling is what it's called.
Yeah, it's early virtue signaling.
Believing in things is stupid, and it makes you weak and a sissy.
And look, I think I've been pretty clear in this episode that Hollywood phonies do exist, and there are a lot of, like, fake people who do pretend to care about something, but don't really. And I think that is worth aiming at. But I also think they could have shown that there are people that actually care and would do something, and they're not just doing it to feel better about themselves.
Yeah, and I don't think real Hollywood phonies actually do activism like chaining themselves to trees. They have, it's sort of like the Lindsay of Arrested Development having just nice social gatherings for causes she doesn't understand.
They'd have a fucking party. Yeah, fucking A. I mean, the Ellen thing recently is like the kid. All the people complimenting her, all the other famous people like, yeah, thanks for saying that, Ellen. It was just like disappointment parade of just like, even if you had agreed with her, you could just say nothing. You don't have to like give her a bunch of hearts back of like, yes, this is about empathy. Like, ugh, ugh.
It's a famous people circle jerk. But it kind of felt like this very disappointing line, if you remember, reminded me a lot of Team America, World Police.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like that is two-thirds of just a fucking masterpiece. Just it's so funny and so pointed and so satirical. And when they're taking on American foreign policy, when they're taking on Michael Bay movies, like it's so brilliant when they're like, Michael Moore is fat and he eats lots of donuts. He's got crumbs around his face because he's such a fatty. I'm like, no, that isn't satire. That's just... cruelty, you know? And it's kind of a similar thing when they're just like, man, you know, the Hollywood celebs are all such phonies and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, hey, you know, that's an exhausted topic. And then B, like, yeah, it's also very facile. They're not really saying anything insightful. You're just repeating something kind of cliched.
When I saw I only watched part of her apology in quotes video, but she made a statement like, when people get angry, they tweet. And I think a lot of this, with comics especially, is they're not used to being challenged, and they're upset that there is now a venue in which they can be challenged and made fun of and criticized when that was not the case 20 years ago.
With Ellen, it felt more like just she's rich and doesn't like being questioned in general, especially when she, you know, she does have like the liberal bona fides of being a gay celebrity trailblazer in that regard. And as a gay man myself, like it at first was like, I really don't like being mad at Ellen. But then especially when like she's smiling and hanging out with a man who, among his many crimes, worked very hard to prevent her and me from being married. That I'm like, no, that is unforgivable. This is not a racist uncle at Thanksgiving. This is a man who tried to destroy your life personally, directly you. And like, I'm not into that forgiveness of a billionaire shit.
Yeah. And I kind of feel the same way about Bill Clinton in 2019, where it's if you're hanging around with him, you're palling around with him, like that speaks really ill of you. And you lost to that fucking Jeffrey Epstein. Yeah. You know, Rabin wasn't that unusual.
I think they put him behind a curtain somewhere.
Yeah, it's funny. Our friends on the podcast, Michael and us, they did an episode about what will probably be Bill Clinton's final public appearance, that tour he did with Hillary last year, of like the speaking tour thing, which seemed incredibly self-indulgent. Like, and now I'm hoping we never have to see Bill Clinton again.
Like, we've heard enough from you, Bill Clinton. Go write your shitty detective novel or your thrillers with James Patterson.
That's right. Yeah. The
the president. President's neck is missing.
I read My Life, his memoir. Literally, two of the 10 worst books I've ever read were My Life by Bill Clinton and The Art of the Deal. Like, literally, this is what a terrible book my life is.
Well, did you recently hear how Hillary was so brave at not divorcing Bill? And it was it was not unlike having the bravery of standing by your transgender child. It's very similar.
Old people who are out of date and have way too much money. See, that's the thing, is I will never be out of touch because I don't have money. And it's hard to be, you know, apart from society and above society when you have to participate in society. Mm-hmm. Make a living.
It's ironic you participate in society while complaining about it.
That should be illegal. Let's get to the trees.
Yeah, sorry. Swartzwelder has really turned me into a liberal hater today in this episode. But yeah, no. So this whole bit with the trees is very much end of history nihilism too, of like, why even bothering to save the trees? It's stupid. You're wasting your time.
They'll be fine.
You're a dork like Ed Begley.
Self-indulgence, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, I do. Ed Begley Jr., let's talk about him a little. He is really funny in this. It's really him. I guess based on his age and our curse on this show, I am going to play the anti-death portal to make him safe here real quick.
Damn buzzards! I ain't dead yet!
So, yes, Ed Begley Jr., he's, you know, a second-generation actor. He's a famous guy. He usually plays the crunchy hippie in liberal shows. Like, in West Wing, he played basically Bernie Sanders, who said who was doing too many purity politics and got to get a big speech about how he was preventing progress by being by expecting too much of the Democratic Party. A great scene that has aged so well. Very good. And also, yeah, I feel like he's the environmentalist that every famous person knows, which is why he often plays this kind of role that he plays here. And the joke about his electric car, though, in this case, the one that runs on his own self-satisfaction, that's based on him being at a Simpsons party at a science museum, right?
And he couldn't plug in his electric car.
Yes.
And he was like, what do you mean? This is a science museum. So they wrote that joke in to reflect that. I think it was the season 10 premiere party or something like that, or one of the premiere parties.
But yeah, all these rich people chain themselves to trees, which that's not what they do. They would pay people to stand at trees for them, or they'd have a party to raise awareness about these trees. But yes, they chain themselves to trees. The cops show up, who are just as violent as the police cops, and they're going to swab their eyes with pepper spray, which apparently
hippie strength.
That really happened for people who chain themselves to trees in a 1997 thing in the Bay Area. The cops did. There's pictures of this woman being held down, and they have swabs. They are putting pepper spray in her eye directly. Like, they got sued over that, so apparently you can't use that now. I think pepper spray strength has improved so much that they can blind you without having
to just jam it directly onto your eye. Yeah, I think there was some famous tree person who lived around here, picking
a
tree.
Yeah, in Berkeley.
Actually, speaking of Hollywood celebrities who walk the walk, I was thinking about, I guess, Jane Fonda, either just got arrested or is about to get arrested or has expressed her desire to get arrested like once a month. And actually in the 1980s, she fucking lived in a modest house with her husband, Tom Hayden, and be like, oh, okay, I'm a leftist. I'm going to live my ethics and values. And nobody gave her any fucking credit for it.
Yeah.
And you need to hate her. So whether or not you're like, oh, I'm going to live my values and not be a super rich person, or whether you marry Ted fucking Turner, Republicans are going to fucking hate you. No matter what. They're going to see you as a phony, even no matter how far you are willing to go for your beliefs. And I think she's definitely somebody who has been willing to be hated by all of America for that. So, yeah, again, I think, like, despite what this says, not all celebrities are phonies, and not all celebrities are just pretending or trying to make themselves look good by pretending to care about the world and the environment.
I like Ruffalo had a nice statement about the Ellen thing of like, no, we're not forgiving this guy. Why the fuck would you? So Ruffalo's still positive. But yes, the cop...
I think she made Ruffalo angry. I don't think she would like him when he's angry.
I just saw something about the Berkeley tree person. Someone was living in a tree to protest the chopping down of said trees for seemingly good purposes, but also believed that the Illuminati and the Masons were conspiring to build this athletic center because the grove is at the intersection of the School of Business and Alcatraz. So it's like dark magic.
You know, those ley lines are real things, Bob. I believe I agree with this guy. I'm shocked there wasn't a Jewish conspiracy mentioned in there, though, too. That usually
Illuminati is, you know, I'm touching my nose. It's just like, you know what that means.
But yes, as they're chained to the trees, the cops show up.
Oh, Marge, I thought it would be fun to be on Springfield's A-list, but these people are nuts.
You can't blame them for having a social conscience.
Sure you can. Bunch of no good do-gooders.
Hang in there, Max. Saving the environment is a hard, grueling job.
That's what I'm saying. See, Marge, this guy gets it.
going on here?
We can't allow you to destroy these beautiful trees, which have the same rights you have.
Man, I have really had it with you tree huggers.
Tree huggers.
Something funny, Nature Boy?
No. I just thought it was cute when you called him.
Yeah, all right, Max Power. Eddie, swab this Joker's eyes with mace.
Swab? I thought it was a spray.
Okay, she's second.
God, yeah. Marge, a lot of cruelties inflicted on Marge.
A lot of bad stuff happens to her. She's punished for talking every time. And yeah, so Homer gets chased by the swab. He then runs with the chain so much that it tears apart the tree's trunk, knocks it over, and knocks down every other tree in the forest. Homer kills
And he kills
forest.
A bird, too.
Yeah, that's the best gag. He kills a bald eagle, not just any old
bird. Just by tossing chains up in the air.
It's a horrible way to kill a bird. Bob, you've made me notice how much bird cruelty there is in just
every
show.
Buddy hates birds. It's true.
Though there's a good little, also very Swartzweldery joke of one cop can't catch Homer, and then two cops just run in a circle in the same way. That's a good little gag. But yes, Homer and everybody learns the lesson of caring is stupid in this tree-killing finale.
This is terrible.
So Trent, where's the party bus headed now? What?
Well, I'm glad you changed your name back to Homer Simpson.
Yes. I learned you gotta be yourself. Good night, honey.
Good night.
Oh, I almost forgot. While I was at the courthouse, I had them change your name.
To what?
Chesty LaRue.
Chesty LaRue?
Just try it for 2 weeks. If you're not completely satisfied, you can be Busty St. Clair.
I don't want to be Chesty LaRue or Busty St. Clair.
Fine, Hootie McBoob it is.
Good night, Homer.
Sleep tight, Hootie.
Let go of those.
They're all just like Russ Meyer character names.
Yes. It's a really weird ending after the trip they've been on. Homer's like, you know what? I'm not this name anymore. We're not talking about the scene that just ended. And here's some funny joke names I'd write for you. The end. Boom. Just.
I still have all those pseudonyms in my head, though, Hootie that he McBoob gives her. Yeah. Chesty LaRue, Busty St. Clair, and Hootie McBoob. And then all of Homer's he had. There's a lot of good fake names in this episode.
Chesty LaRue is a good one. But then Homer gropes Marge, which is just like, come on, Homer.
Yeah, Chesty LaRue is one of those where, like, I know that phrase. I didn't necessarily know that it came from here. I'm like, I mean, but it's like a Mel Brooks thing. Chesty LaRue definitely does sound like somebody who would be in a Russ Meyer movie with Pandora cheeks.
Chesty LaRue does sound like a Mel Brooks, like, secretary character in one of his 60s or 70s ones. Yeah, you know, that was a funny episode that then kind of takes a weird off-ramp into complaining about Hollywood liberals. But, you know, couldn't be more timely today, I suppose.
Yeah, I agree. I'm not a huge fan of the where it swerves into, but I love all the Max Power stuff. And I still have a lot of lines from this episode in my head, like, this is the wrong way, but faster, strapping in feel the G's, and all of the fun pseudonyms. So,
and the mid-season talk, too.
Yeah. There's a lot of great, like, super wacky Swartzwelder stuff in here, especially the police cops thing. And lots of fun stuff. I did like this episode.
Yeah, it's very good. And again, I think the first two acts of it are really, really great and very, very funny. And I feel like it really falls apart at the end. But yeah, it's very, very funny. And I hadn't watched this in a while. And I was reminded why this is my favorite show and maybe the funniest television show of all time.
We're glad we could remind you then.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Thank you so much, Nathan. Please plug all of your stuff. You got so much going on, a book coming out, and of course your Patreon. You're writing so much wonderful stuff online still.
My big things are my website, Nathan Rabin's Happy Place, NathanRabin.com, NathanRabin, .com. That's kind of my main thing. I update constantly. Got a column for TCM Backlot called Fractured Mirror. That's about movies about movies. I got a column for them called First and Last, about the first and last films of film. Makers. I have a book coming out called The Weird Accordion to Al, the book. It's an adaptation of a column that I've been writing for my website for the last 2.5 years, where I go back and write about every single song on every Weird Al album in chronological order. And I got this idea because I wrote his coffee table book, and in 2017, when I started my site, really wanted to think about something good and wonderful instead of Donald Trump. so I decided to immerse myself into the world of Weird Al Yankovic, and it's been really, really amazing. And we've got amazing illustrations by Felipe Cerrero, who does a lot of art for podcast stuff. He's also a colorist for Marvel. It's really great. We've got a introduction by Weird Al Yankovic, which I am very, very, very excited about. He's actually going to fact check it as well.
Oh boy.
And then, yeah, this is exciting. You're probably the first people to hear this. I've had a podcast for the last 2 years called Nathan Rabin's Happy Cast. We are going to reboot it in about a month and a half. I was watching the movie The Fanatic, the John Travolta flop directed by Fred. I'm thinking about how much I adore John Travolta, about like he's just one of my favorite actors and people and icons in history, and how much I love Nicolas Cage. So I said, fuck it, I should just do a podcast where me and my co-host Clint Worthington, where we just talk about John Travolta and Nicolas Cage movies.
Ooh.
So in about a month, we're going to start a podcast called Travolta / Cage. And in every single episode, we and a guest will talk about one John Travolta movie and one Nicolas Cage movie. Do that in chronological order. And we're very, very excited. There's a lot of crazy, funky, cool shit. And we got great guests. And yeah, I feel like this is a, like your podcast, a good, you know, a juicy commercial idea that hopefully will resonate with people. So I'm very, very excited about that. Travolta / Cage.
That's great. And personally speaking, you've been hugely influential to both Henry and I in the way that we cover media. So thank you so much for being on the show. It's been great.
Oh, it's been a pleasure. It's been a real joy.
Thanks again to Nathan Rabin for being on the show. We are big fans of him, so make sure you check out all of his stuff. But as for us, if you want to check out more of our stuff and support our show, please go to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. If you sign up for the low cost of $5 a month, you'll get access to all of our paywalled podcasts behind the $5 paywall. That includes all of our limited miniseries and so much more, but it also includes our upcoming series, Talking Futurama Season 2 Part 1, will be happening starting in late October, running until the end of the year. And if you want access to that, you'll have to join us at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons for $5 a month. And Henry will tell you all about what is happening at the $10 level. Super long podcast every month, often longer than 4 hours, which is crazy, but nice.
Yes, for all of our premium supporters at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, you'll get access to our monthly What a Cartoon Movie podcast, where me and Bob talk about a different animated feature film once a month for up to 4 hours. We've talked about most recently Cowboy Bebop the movie, and if you sign up in October, you'll not only get to hear that, but our upcoming one, The Nightmare Before Christmas, our Halloween treat for all of you. So please sign up at the $10 level to get that and all of the previous $5 benefits Bob just talked about. Once more, that's patreon.com/talkingsimpsons.
So as for me, I've been one of your hosts, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo. My other podcast is Retronauts. It's a classic gaming podcast. Every Monday and occasionally on Friday, go to Retronauts.com or look for Retronauts in your podcast machine, and I think you'll like it. What about you, Henry?
You can follow me on Twitter at HENEREYG. You'll get all the Henry Gilbert updates there, especially whenever new podcasts for Talking Simpsons or What a Cartoon come out. I am sure to tweet about it, and you'll learn about it there. So please stay informed by following me on Twitter, HENEREYG.
Thanks for joining us, folks. We'll see you next week for I'm with Cupid, and we will see you then.
Oh, wait a minute. The family name is my legacy to you. I got it from my father, and he got it from his father, and he traded a mule for it. And that mule went on to save spring break.